we do this every month. It's a monthly comic creator meeting. We make an anthology every so often. We have, you know, this is the South Bay comic book scene. So these are our babies right here. And lots of aspiring young minds and old minds and the future of comics. Tanya Bjork is here. I'm saying that sober. So with that said, I left all my questions up front. Needs questions when I run out of questions? And you guys, this is a conversation. This is the reason we didn't let people know what was happening today is because we didn't want a line of people hunting for autographs or asking when Hellboy 3 is coming out. That's not what this is about. This is about making comics. This is about Mike's career. This is about Christine kicking ass on his behalf out there in the world. And the challenges, all that good stuff that comes up when you make comics. I mean, it's still a struggle, right? I mean, you're successful. It's not a struggle. Can you tell people it is just to
have some drama?
Well, just say life is busy every day. I mean,
it's busy.
Yeah, it's busy.
Busy, yes.
Oh, thank you, Gary. Oh, you're the best.
At some point, it's kind of like you got to stay up, keep your head above water.
Mm-hmm.
So there's constantly a kind of, we got to put out, or putting out fires is actually.
There's, constant challenges.
Yeah.
Constant.
So let's roll back to the beginning. And, you know, people can read about your career in books and stuff. So this is really more about Christine today. Sorry, Mike. Excellent. But thanks for coming.
All right.
When you met this guy, there was no Hellboy movie. There was not even Hellboy yet.
No.
It was very little. It was very little.
What
to
were
recommend.
You doing before
I worked in the fashion industry in New York for 20 years. So I worked for Liz Claiborne. So I have a big business background. And I was a national sales manager there. And then we had a kid.
Yeah.
And so I left.
And a movie.
Oh, and a movie. So that helped. And plus we moved. What we did was, we didn't have a movie yet when I quit.
No.
I quit. I had Katie. I quit. We moved to Portland. And the reason why we moved to Portland was because Dark Horse is located there.
Mm-hmm.
And we felt it was more important for him to be close to the publisher because he was just starting Hellboy. Because Katie was born, Hellboy was born 21 years ago in March, and Katie came along in April. So, we just thought it was a good place to live to,
It's okay. Keep talking. It's the guy from Mexico.
We just thought it was important for him to be close to the publisher, so he could just go over there and also...
But it's horrible there. It does nothing but rain.
I wasn't a fan because I'm a New Yorker, and I went there, and I was totally out of my element. So we lasted there 6 years, moved back to New York. Is that answering the question?
No, not at all. And then you went back to work.
And then I went back to work, and I went to work for Jones New York. So I have, all my ties are with the fashion industry. But my
then,
feeling
then
is...
the movie happened.
And then the movie happened, and then I quit, and because he
just—it's too
much. I was doing this job plus that job, plus my mother was older, and I was doing that, and Katie.
And this was really before there was a lot of social media or anything like that.
There was no social media.
But he had a very strong business background.
I have a very strong business background.
Yeah, okay, which is important.
Yeah.
Questions, anybody? Yes, Kelly.
So how did your business evolve? At what point were you able to start supporting yourself and your family? And now that you guys are very successful, you know, how has your business changed, if you don't mind going?
It's the entire topic. I always supported myself, but then I always lived very cheaply. So that was kind of my... I knew what I wanted to do. I thought I knew what I wanted to do. And I knew I wanted to do it for a really long time. So I figured I would always live very cheaply. So I wasn't doing jobs necessarily for the money as much as I was doing, this would be a fun job or that'd be a fun job. I mean, at the beginning, you got to take whatever jobs you can get. But you had in mind where you wanted to get to. So I've always supported myself when it was just me. And then
I supported us.
Well, we were living in New York City,
so
it took two
people
to pay the bills.
Yeah.
And then
And then when
Hellboy,
it was when we moved to Portland that you started just supporting. That was when Hellboy
and then the Hellboy thing snowballed. I mean, as soon as there was a movie, it just snowballed, and that's why I always, you know, my advice is, if you can live with it, you know, get a movie. easier said than done, I know, but it does help.
And I think something that's really important that he's always done, it's always been not doing it for the money, which I know nobody wants to hear, but he does it for the love of what he does.
Yeah, I mean that's a whole gigantic subject, you know, is how do you get to that point? I mean, for me, I knew the kind of stuff I wanted to do. I took whatever jobs I could get, but you're always looking to position yourself where you're doing the job, not only that you want to do, but the job you can do really well. Because ultimately what you want to do is be recognized for, you know, who you are and what you do. And this is, you know, me crawling through mainstream comics for 10 years. So eventually you get some kind of a reputation. You don't take on more work than you can do because you want to do your best work. I had an editor who's still friends, a friend of mine, but he pushed me to do so much more work than I could do well, and that's when I learned to hate the term "it's good enough." For a while there I did like 2 books a month. I only did layouts. I was at the mercy of the guy who inked me. In one case I was inked by a good guy, in the other case I was inked by a horrible guy. Both books are not very good. So it was a good 4 months for money, but as a result, it was 4 months or 5 months, whatever it was, of work that did absolutely nothing for my career. And so many guys fall into that trap of, oh, I've got to take all the work and I've got to do this for the money and blah, 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 blah. And what they've done is they've produced a body of work that nobody gives a shit about. So you got to find the time or the right project to put your best foot forward.
Well, there was also a time where, like, when the first, I guess it was the first Hellboy trade came out, and the numbers weren't what we thought they were going to be, and you wanted to go back to
either. It was the first comic. Yeah.
Okay. And he decided that he didn't necessarily, he wanted to go over to Marvel or DC and do a big book to make some money. And I was like, you can't do that. You have to stick with it. You have to, this is what you want to do. And the luxury was I was working at the time, so he could really focus on that.
Kind of on that subject, when did you, like, I guess, describe that point where you think you got, like, you caught lightning in a bottle and you realized that you kind of, this, okay, something, you've got something here, you know, I figured there's a bit.
That I thought, or
both
him?
She still isn't sure. and I'm not sure. I mean, at some point you do the math. And you go, I guess this is going to work. But I never had that moment. I had the moment where when I did the third Hellboy story, which I had so much fun doing, and I had a couple artists I really respect call me and say, that's great. That's the best thing you've ever done. And when I realized that and I thought, oh, I had fun doing it and these guys really like it, if the book can be this, then I can do this book. Because the second one, the first one I wrote myself was a nightmare. I have no confidence, and it was pulling teeth. The third one was so much fun, and people liked it. So, but still, we weren't in that thing of, oh, and it sells a gazillion copies, so you know it's all working. I just knew that I could keep doing this book. And maybe it'll take off, maybe it won't take off. We certainly never thought there'd ever be a movie or anything. So, and at that point you were still working.
Yeah.
But also we knew moving to Portland, we knew it was going to be cheap there. And that was part of the thinking there, at least for me, was let's go someplace where I can do this, where you don't have to work, you can take care of the baby, and It's gonna be cheap. We'll live cheap. I always wanted to live cheap. New York City always scared the shit out of me. I always thought if I had a bad day, you know, I didn't get a page drawn today. We're gonna be homeless. I never really got that there was something between living in New York City and being homeless.
years of therapy to sort that out.
You know, real quick, so like you touched on something about, you know, adjusting your real life, you know, so you can afford to do the things you want to do. And I think a lot of us creators have that disconnect between, okay, this is what you have to do. This is, you know, this is how you pay rent or your mortgage. And you know, if you're self-publishing, this is how you self-publish it. But, and being self-reliant, which is something that, you know, we've talked about before. You have any advice on that? Or like, how, like, I remember you were listening to a panel or talking, and it was about if you make 10 cents, save 5 cents.
No, that was
can
always
you tell that story?
The story, we always, you know, a lot of people get in trouble in this business. They have the IRS knocking on their door because they don't realize that's always been my thing. If you get paid a dime in this business, you have to take 5 cents of that and stick it away because the IRS is going to come knocking on your door. It's just a fact. It's just, we live in America. They're going to come and collect the taxes.
I've heard so many stories of a guy. They get their big royalty check, and so the first thing they do is go buy a car. You know, it's like, dude, and it's also, that might be the only time you get that royalty check. Yeah, it's not guaranteed, unless you're Eric Larson. It's not guaranteed you're going to get one every month.
But that's always been my thing. It's like, I think my father drilled it in my head. It's always been, I mean, you know, it's not like we just all of a sudden had all this money. I mean, I remember like weekends I couldn't eat either because I didn't budget myself correctly. But it's just, especially in this business, it's so dangerous because you get paid as a freelancer. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's like if you have 10 cents, break it into two nickels and take that other nickel and put it away. And also, you might not have to pay that much on taxes, but there's other things. There's like health care and, you know, how many people have been caught short lately with that, you know?
That's why the Hero Initiative exists, but the Hero Initiative can only do so much.
Yeah. And you know, and we're constantly getting, you know, again, emails of so-and-so is sick and can you help them out? And it's an awful thing.
Where the original art goes, start having a separate pile for original art that was going to be set aside for the inevitable, this guy's sick, we got to do an auction, blah, blah, blah. There's so much of that.
Yeah, it's one of those things that if you guys haven't looked into it or whatever, it's so important because you don't know what tomorrow's going to bring. My father also, I got to say, he was the one who instilled in us, like, you know, retirement plans. And so, you know, it was like, after I would get a paycheck, like with my first job that I made $120 a week at, it was a while ago, I'd have like, you know, $20 to my name. It was just because all of that money, he was like, nope, retirement, healthcare, and, you know, your taxes.
Yeah.
And so that's always been my chant. Not that anybody wants to hear it, but...
Somebody posted on Facebook a while ago, you know, out of curiosity, how many of you are putting money away for retirement?
Retirement. Yeah.
And you know, it's like cartoonists answering. And so many of these guys said, well, my retirement plan is, I'll never be able to retire. And you go, no, at some point, this shit becomes a lot of work. And maybe, I mean, I don't plan to ever really retire because what am I going to retire from? I make up shit and I draw pictures of monsters. But at some point, I would like to not have to.
Right.
You know, I would like...
Have it be like something you want to do.
Or, heaven forbid, you do get sick or, you know, whatever else. You want that option. But, you know, I mean, it's still, I think that one thing that I think is nice and exciting about the comics industry now is that there are so many guys who don't look at doing it for a living, who have some kind of a day job, mm-hmm. so they get to do whatever the hell they want when it comes to doing comics, whether it's self-publishing or whatever it is. It is trickier and more difficult, and there's more compromise if you say, no, this is what I'm going to do full-time, I'm just going to be a cartoonist. And that's when you really have to figure out how to do that and how to get where you're going. You just have to decide if it's... I mean, for me, I can't do anything else. So I had to figure out how to make a living at it. Having a plan B or having a safety net thing, that's great. I never had that.
And so I was...
You married Plan B.
Yeah, I married Plan B.
Marry a smart woman or guy.
You know, you realize you've been walking a tightrope for a long time without a net. It'd be really good to have a net.
Thank you.
But net's nice and comfortable. It, yeah.
It's pretty net.
But yes. But yeah, I mean, so that's why, you know, I never thought I would create my own thing. I figured I would, you know, be a work for hire guy. Never really occurred to me to do anything else. So it was just my whole thing was take whatever I can get at Marvel Comics and work my way until there's a book that I'm really comfortable on where I get to draw monsters. That's pretty much my, that was actually beyond my wildest dreams when I started. I was just going to be an inker. Who could be in the business, and maybe someday before I died, I'd do a 10-page backup feature in Savage Sword of Conan so I could say, oh, I drew a comic. I mean, that was my goal. You know, I did that reasonably quickly, but also I was terrible. I was a terrible artist. So, and that's what you know, that's what I want to do for a living. So you have to get better. And then you have to find the right projects. And you know, I did a lot of the wrong projects. I mean, for years, people just did not want me drawing their comics. It wasn't until I got over and did Batman, and there were a couple other things I did that people went, well, that's kind of okay.
Your Dracula thing was cool. I like that.
Yeah, but it was a different planet by that time I did Dracula.
Yeah.
So have you set it up where you have a steady stream of income coming in from multiple things, or is it just...
Nope, it's, you know, every year's different, but yeah, it's every year is different. I mean, there's some years, you know, the movie years were woohoo,
yeah.
And now it's been pretty steady for the past couple of years, but you know, I know that's a hard thing to manage,
right.
You know, like
one, have a sudden influx, yeah, and then yeah, this year is just, you know,
only, yeah, and yeah, that I guess is just a matter of budgeting and you know,
and preparing for the bad, for the inevitable bad years. I mean, you just don't know. I mean, we've gotten to the point, we've got so damn many books in print, which is great, that we can kind of guess what our royalties are going to be.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot, you know, the bulk of our income, or a lot of our income, at least half, more than half, is those royalties.
Oh. I think
for 20 years worth of the Hellboy, yeah, stuff.
I think also managing. You can get a lot of free financial guidance from people who can help you out with that. And like, people don't know that that's available. Like, you can walk into any of the banks and they'll help you out with how to, you know, gauge that and make sure your taxes are paid and, you know, for free. As long as you have an account. Of mm-hmm. course, everybody's going to go to Bank America next week and say, they're going to say, it's not free.
I guess I was wondering, is the merchandising, does that, the merchandise, the shirts and those things, does that help smooth out the income, or is it not really?
Yeah.
That's,
yeah,
all, that's,
yeah,
that's great.
It's kind of like gravy. It's kind of,
okay,
yeah,
ancillary, I guess.
It's,
and we,
it's,
yeah, we,
it's
also,
a secondary,
yeah,
thing.
The thing is that we do all our own t-shirts. I do it with a Manhattan stitching guy over here. He's,
oh, right,
great,
around the corner?
He's amazing. If you ever want to, like, go into the t-shirt business, I always try to do local because it's just what we do.
Yeah.
Well, so you can go there and talk to the guy about what you,
yeah,
want.
Well, yeah. And he's terrific over there. But I know that you have to do somewhat quantity and then hold the quantity and then actually ship them yourself. That's the difference between using one of those services and actually doing it. And trust me,
well, Richard will bring it down, though.
Or Richard will take,
yeah,
care of
take
it.
Them.
But yeah, a lot of her day, especially when we have any kind of new product, mm-hmm, is packing.
I'm warehouse, I'm everything, I do everything.
So if somebody orders something from the Art of Hellboy website, handle
I do,
getting it
I,
down there.
Within 24 hours, it goes out.
And she does a very nice job.
Yeah, it's a lot of work, I bet.
I've had the guy over in the post office comment and say, you pack up really nicely.
And people have to...
You sure that's what he meant?
When people get the stuff... when people get the stuff, they comment on how, yeah, nice, because it's wrapped in tissue and it's got a sticker that holds the tissue closed, and it's just... It's those little things,
little touches
that make
a big difference.
Yeah, and like getting the quality T-shirt. you know, getting a nice feeling T-shirt.
You can all feel Richard's T-shirt.
Yeah. He would love that. Yeah. 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 And our prints too, which is that. I mean, that's a delicate matter because it doesn't take much to end a print, or I mean, it's
And all of our prints are. We work with Dave Stewart. He actually produces the prints for us and then ships them down to us, and everything comes with a certificate of authenticity, which people love just as much as they love the print. But it's just like keeping it quality and making sure that it's shipped with like a lot of cardboard.
Half of our garage is filled with cardboard of various sizes.
Yeah.
I guess what are some of the lessons learned from Hellboy, and I guess what else worked really well for you that you maybe didn't expect to?
What's worked well for us? Beer.
Oh yeah, that beer sold out like really quickly.
Yeah.
Chocolate.
Yeah, it's when you do stuff. If we're talking about the merchandise stuff, it's when you do stuff that isn't the usual stuff, like having the signing, and chocolate wasn't our idea, but Meltdown contacted a chocolate guy, and so we had this line of chocolate bars. Recently, Rogue Beer in Portland wanted to do a Hellboy beer. So you do these things, and it's not, though I guess the chocolate's still available.
It is.
But the sense is it's kind of a niche little thing, as opposed to one big massive thing that's there for so long that everybody's bored with it.
So those things are like little surprises. Like to us, they're like, oh yeah, of course we want a beer with Hellboy on it. You know, but you don't know, and it was sold out in 3 days.
But and not big money at all from our end of things. But it's cool, and it gets attention, so it keeps the brand kind of out there.
But as far as things that we would have done differently.
We've been really lucky and smart. I mean, we just haven't gone down the wrong
road. There's certain things like certain prints would I have done 1,000 or versus 200. You know, like there's always a number game too that we play with. Like we don't know how many is enough or how many is too many. So I mean, those are simple.
You know, we've had a few conversations in the past and, say as much or as little, but not so much what you would have done differently, but what you see other artists doing, and not just, people who we don't know who they are, but, like, artists that are popular in the comic book industry right now. What should they be thinking about? What could they be, besides saving a nickel, but, like, career-wise, I guess to break it down, you told me once you were so glad this Hellboy thing worked out, and that you had something that you could fall back on, and that there's a lot of popular artists out there that don't have their Hellboy.
Yeah, it's funny. I wonder, I would think in 10 years from now, or 5 years, or 2 years from now, or maybe it's already now, I think you're going to see fewer and fewer artists who think or delude themselves that they're going to be in mainstream comics the whole time. Because sooner or later, they always get a different artist on Batman. You might think you got it made and you're going to buy the giant house and you're always going to be the artist on Batman. But you might want to have something else cooking in the back. I mean, it's like, if you're end all be all, and I've met a few of these guys, all they ever want to do is Batman or all they ever want to do is Spider-Man, great. That's great. Sooner or later, it's going to end. Nobody can convince you it's going to end, but it's going to end. But my advice to guys is always like, kind of parlay your success into something that's yours, that you can control. I mean, if a guy, I have met guys, they're really good at, they can draw anything, so they're happy just to bounce one job to the other forever. But it's the guys who come up to me and say, I really want to do something, I want to do this thing, but Marvel's paying me this much or DC's paying me this much. It's like, that's my one piece of career advice to these guys is, if you really want to do your own thing, just before you re-up your contract or in between big commercial jobs, take a couple months, build in a couple months, or do it, one page a week, on Sundays, whatever it is, and do your own thing if you want to do your own thing. And get it out there. It doesn't have to be this 900-page giant epic. I mean, when I started Hellboy, it was not, 25 trade paperbacks. It was, one miniseries. Or, you know, do one comic. You're for Christ's sakes, you're the artist on Spider-Man or Batman. People are going to look at this other thing you do. And unless you put out something that's really what you want to do, you're never going to find out if it could be successful. So try it is the one thing I'm always saying to guys. But I do think, yeah, the business has changed so much and there is so much benefit to owning your own thing or even co-owning it with a writer or an artist, whoever you have to work with. There are so many benefits. I'm always saying to the Batman guys, you know, when they decide to reboot Batman, nobody's calling you to ask your permission or to give you a bucket of money to make that Batman thing. And not that we're, you know, necessarily doing this stuff in order to make a movie, but just t-shirts and just being able to control your thing.
How does that affect you as a creator? Do you feel trapped by Hellboy? Do you have little ideas in the back of your head that you just wish could get out? Or...
Yeah, I mean, I have little ideas. I mean, and that's how I did, you know, The Amazing Screw-On Head and all the other short stories that ended up collected with The Amazing Screw-On Head. But right now, I turned Hellboy into something where anything I do, especially now that he's in hell, if I wanted a story about a frog doing whatever, I can do that in Hellboy in Hell. You know, a frog tells his story. Fine. Perfect. And that's actually what a lot of Hellboy in Hell was supposed to be. But then I got to the point where I just said, you know, if I've got the really weird stuff, I'll just make the time for it and do it separate. I mean, it's easy. You know, Dark Horse will do anything I want, which is nice. But I made up Hellboy so I wouldn't feel trapped. I made up Hellboy so anything I ever wanted to do, I could do there. And especially, yeah, once I throw him into hell, it's just my fantasy world. So, you know, yeah, I don't feel trapped at all. I do look forward to a time where I wrap up the big Hellboy story and then I just can draw pictures or, you know, commissions or do whatever the hell I want.
And well, real quick, so, you know, I read an interview with you once where, yeah, you did create Hellboy as a vessel with which you could tell any kind of story, like all the things that influenced you when you were younger, you know, Dracula and H.P. Lovecraft, all that stuff is in Hellboy. Richard, too, with, you know, Blade Runner, and it's all in Elfman. If you look at Elfman, if you look at Hellboy, you see these things, and they're from different, you know, genres, different worlds, but you have a vessel in which you can tell any kind of story you want, which is something you guys want to think about when you're creating your opuses.
You can tell a story. Once you've established a thing, you can tell a story that people will actually buy. Always, I mean, good. there were a couple English folk tales. When I started Hellboy, there were two English folk tales on my mental shelf that I really wanted to do straight adaptations of. One of them became the Hellboy story of the corpse, and one of them became the Hellboy story of the chained coffin. I had planned to do straight adaptations of both those stories. Who the hell would have bought them? Irish folktale adapted by Mike Mignola, who we never heard of. Yay! Now we can buy a house. That shit's not going to happen. So suddenly you realize with a character like that, you go, I've got this character. I can do whatever I want with him, which means any other story, or in a lot of cases, any story I want to do, I can just throw him into it. Say I'm drawing a picture. I want to draw a picture of an old house. There are a lot of days where I just want to draw a picture of an old house or an old statue. Guess what? Throw Hellboy in the front of that house. Throw Hellboy in the front of that statue. You've just gone from drawing a picture that it goes, that's nice. You're going to have to keep that forever because nobody wants it, to, oh shit, a Hellboy drawing. Ah, we want that. I learned that from Barry Smith. There's a wonderful drawing of a forest that Barry Smith did. I saw this, you know, I was in high school, I think, when I saw this drawing. A catalog came out with this drawing in it, and it's little text piece that went with it where somebody had said to Barry, oh, it's a great forest and there's like a little robed figure with a skull head, tiny, in the drawing. And somebody said to Barry, you just put in the skeleton guy so you can sell the piece. And he's like, yeah. And I was like, ding! Make up a guy that everybody likes and then draw whatever the hell you want with him standing in the picture. That's the way my brain's been working for a really long time. I want to get paid for doing whatever the hell I want. Hellboy's mine. It's not. People can't pitch me Hellboy stories. I've got all the Hellboy stories I need. I got more than enough Hellboy stories. And I work with a couple, only a few writers on the Hellboy-related stuff. So we maintain a certain consistency. I'm not looking... Part of the problem to me with Marvel and DC Comics, as far as any kind of continuity goes, is there's 60,000 different people writing this stuff, and this guy's undoing what this guy did, and this guy doesn't like this guy, so he's going to make sure that story was just a dream, and then continuity eventually just went away entirely. When we do eventually wrap this stuff up, it will be a consistent story. We're telling one big story. BPRD will end. We're working on the end of that book. Hellboy is already dead, so it's really hard to end him, but I have put together all the things that I need to do to complete his story. I'm very story, considering I'm an artist, I'm very story driven. I am telling a story. I'm not just trying to sell t-shirts. I'm not, you know, trying to keep this brand alive so we can sell underoos, you know? We can really, I know it's we, that idea. Actually isn't bad. I'm telling a story. So the whole thing isn't just to keep it alive, though it's nice, and to some extent we will continue to own Hellboy. And I can't imagine a time where I don't do Hellboy drawings and little Hellboy stories. But, you know, right now, Hellboy in Hell looks like it's going to be just four books. And that will tell all the stuff I need to tell with Hellboy. But he's my baby, you know, and he's in hell where he can do whatever he wants. So I can see doing other stuff with him. But I want to finish telling this big story. And I don't want to get hit by a bus or get sick or whatever before I finish my big story.
So knock on wood, you will outlive the character. Or we don't have wood here.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the character is not meant to go on forever. Though, I guess since he's already dead, he can. But what my daughter inherits is the trademark, the copyright, and the body of work that we've produced. So hopefully, I mean, the trick will be is even if Dark Horse goes away, do all those books, which at this point they're like 60 books of the Hellboy-related stuff. Wow. Does that stuff stay in print? You know, is that... I can't imagine that some of that stuff won't stay in print, especially it'd be great to get another movie, you know, keep this thing alive. You know, it might be 20 years from now that somebody contacts, you know... Well, it'd be nice if they contacted us in 20 years. But 20 even if years, we're, yeah. Like, even in whatever, some other number of years where we're years not now. There, yeah. It'd be nice if somebody wants to do a Hellboy, I don't know if they'll have movies, whatever, some kind of thing where you're projecting it inside somebody's head. Somebody goes, oh, that character Hellboy. You know, it's we own that character. She will own that character. And you know, things, formats come and go, movies come and go. But these characters, like Indiana Jones, like the Star Wars characters, like Hellboy, like Superman, like Batman, you know, that's the thing that's, you know, that we own. You know, we have one of those guys. Maybe we have a couple, hopefully.
Skipper.
If you, you know, worst case scenario, you don't get a chance to finish Hellboy for whatever reason.
If I get sick, I got to write a lot of notes really fast.
You know, the proverbial bust.
Yeah.
Do you really want someone finishing your book, or it's like, let it go?
I'll be dead.
You don't care.
I don't care. No, I mean, it would be nice
you'll
if somebody
making
finished
it. Hell, like,
it'd be nice if somebody finished it. And I've told my editor so many times where things are going, he could probably finish it.
And I won't know.
And so. She won't know. She doesn't know what the hell is going on. So,
I think you told me how it ends in case, you know, anything goes down.
Oh, God,
it wasn't my fault.
I say trust your memory. I don't really trust anybody's memory for that stuff. But that's why I did, you know, say, well, okay, 4 trade paperbacks. If I don't do a billion conventions, if I kind of focus, I can get to it in the next maybe 5-6 years. So. I just got to stay away from buses till then. Yeah.
So when do you think you really needed to bring in a lawyer to deal with all things?
The first time we brought in a lawyer was when the movie
Mm-hmm. When Mike Richardson said, "This is the best deal we've ever offered anybody. You won't need a lawyer." That's the day we started looking for a lawyer.
Yes. So we had that lawyer, and the lawyer that I use for writing cease and desist letters is the Dark Horse lawyer. Oh. So we have that luxury of not having to pay him.
And this is one of the beauties of our arrangement is that our regular lawyer, the guy who did the Hellboy deal, if he calls on the phone, I immediately hand it to her. Mm-hmm. Not that I don't like the guy, not that I'm not happy to eat dinner with him. I just don't want to know. I don't want to deal with this stuff.
Just not good at dealing with that.
And you know what? You bring up a good point, too, in that, you know, when Dark Horse says, "Oh, this is the best deal we've given anybody." I mean, how are the guys that made The Mask doing? That was a huge movie. How, you know, The Crow wasn't Dark Horse, but I mean, how's James O'Barr doing? How's the guy, the creator of Men in Black? How's he doing? You know,
well,
these anytime multi-million-dollar movies.
Anytime you do a panel with these guys, we all talk about our lawyers and we all talk about our deals and we talk about the deal that we fought for and the deal we didn't fight for. You just need a lawyer when it comes to that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and if you're ever in that situation, you need the lawyer, you got to shop around a little bit, because there's a couple of those comic book lawyers that are out there that are...
What qualities do you look for and when you're hiring?
I don't know for sure.
Just, you know, somebody that, I mean, that comes recommended. Just find somebody who you know, you trust and get a recommendation.
Yeah, I as soon as, you know, we got home from getting that deal from Dark Horse, you know, I went home and I called Comics Guys and said, "Who's your lawyer?" You know, and who has dealt with a comic book property, specifically a comic book property that's being turned into a movie, because they know what to ask for. I haven't the faintest idea what to ask for. There's just so many things. You also don't want a guy who goes, "Oh boy, this is my ticket to either attach myself as a producer or ask for a billion things."
That's what I was saying, that you have to really shop around. Because, like, you'll have guys who want to attach and they want, you know, ridiculous percentage of whatever the movie is. So, you just have to shop around.
Yeah, ask
around. Again, back to your business sense, is probably what helped you in selecting that lawyer, I would imagine.
I didn't select the lawyer. He selected the lawyer. At that point in time, I wasn't really involved in it.
Well, at that time, there were two main lawyers.
There were two main lawyers that were handling everybody's stuff, and one of them we just did not get along with.
Mm-hmm.
And
so we went,
with the other guy, and he's
fine. He's not really in the game as much as he used to be.
He's got his own stuff going on, but he's there for me every time I call. So that's what you want. Also, you want one of them is going to return your phone call, because there's a bunch of them that don't.
How much emotional support is involved in running the Hellboy business?
Oh, jeez. You mean the daily,
I'm terrible,
awful,
my career's over, I think I really screwed up this
there's
time.
There's a lot of that, yeah. Or
Scott
then
Alley gets a fair amount of it,
and then
too,
he'll be like, I'm a genius.
Well, that's it. How many times within one day will you get,
my
career's over, and an hour later, I'm a genius? And it's just,
I mean, it seems to be, we figured out the consistency.
You average it out.
Like you
bring him down when he's really high, and then you pick him up when he's low, I guess.
Stay out of the way.
I stay out of the way.
And let
mostly, I just have to stay out of the way. Because,
that's a lot.
Because I know that it's going to change. It's like, you know, the weather, so.
You're a genius? That's fine. Tell me about that. And if you're still a genius in an hour, let me know. Or you're terrible now. I'm sure it's fine. Go back.
Or he'll be like, you know, and he's like big at, you know, like, I worked on this page all day, and then at 10 o'clock at night, he's like erasing it. And I'm
throwing
like,
it away.
Yeah, and I'm like, you have to leave it there, go away, and look at it tomorrow morning. Because a lot of times
in the garbage. It'll be in two pieces.
I know, but a lot of times you'll look at it and you'll go, oh, that wasn't that bad.
There are those pieces where you just go, every time I look at this, it seems okay for a second, and then it becomes terrible. and you just, up until I give it to her, she does all the scanning. Once I give it to her and she scans it, then I'm afraid to ever ask, like, can I have that page back and fix it? And then you can scan it again. To ask her, she didn't love scanning to begin with. To ask her to scan a page twice, I know if it goes to her, it's like putting it in the mail in the old days. It's in the FedEx envelope and it's gone.
It's locked,
good,
sealed,
bad, or otherwise,
delivered,
it's done. Once she scans it,
that's where the scariness.
That's where the scariness.
Yeah.
So you are. There's a little fright factor, which is good.
It's huge.
Yeah.
Not huge.
What does she do to instill this fear in you?
You've seen her. The look. The look that says, "Really, really,
right?
You need this today?"
And you know she's right usually.
Yeah. I'm horrible. I mean, it's to put up with the shit that she has to put up with. Yeah. I try to make it as easy as possible.
Told you this was a love story.
Yeah, it is.
Here's another question.
You mentioned you have this, pipeline of ideas in your head all the time. Do you write it down? And if you do, is it words or pictures?
I write it down. Usually,
how do you
keep
it organized?
I got files. I got a whole bunch of files for different things. Most of the stuff I write down, then I lose it. So, she does all the real world stuff. All I do is walk around thinking about my crazy shit and working on dialogue for a story that I'm going to do 5 years from now, or the design for the cover for issue 39 of Hellboy in Hell, and I'm on issue 8. I'm constantly doing that shit, and mostly I write it down. But again, a lot of stuff I write it down. I come out of the shower and I write this stuff down, and then God knows what happens to that pad. I might find it 5 years from now at the bottom of a drawer. The scariest thing is always when I'm ready to start on a project and I know I made up a whole bunch of stuff a long time ago, and it's going to that file and opening it up and hoping like hell that those scraps of paper that I wrote are in there.
And then it's as good.
And
as
if they're not there, you're just screwed. And then I've got 6,000 different sketchbooks in my studio, and I know damn well I came up with the trade paperback cover for this book 6 years before I did it. I have no idea what sketchbooks it's in, and I have I don't have the patience to look through them all. So I look through two or three of them. I can't find it. I go, I'll make up something else.
Do you think that, working on Atlantis and just going out and doing things other than Hellboy, do you learn things doing those other projects that you can bring back to Hellboy that sort of, grow as an artist or think of new ways of doing things or something
Mean, well, I did learn, on the movie stuff, doing the Hellboy movie stuff and Blade, I have picked up one thing, which is the importance of doing pre-production for your work. So I've actually now just recently got had a big bulletin board and got a bulletin board mounted on an easel. And so now I have this board covered in some of it's covered in story ideas, a lot of it's covered in photos. So before I do a story now, I will do a little bit of a pre-production period where I will figure out, he's got to go, I'll thumbnail the story, and then I'll go, well, for this scene, what are we looking at for a location? For costumes, what are we looking at? Mm-hmm. And so I will do a certain amount of prep work and have it up on that board before I start the comic. So that's the biggest thing I've picked up from doing the movies.
How do you know when you've done enough of that? I mean, that can suck you down a rabbit hole, or
yeah, mostly it's just impatience. I mean, that's the fun stuff, doing the research and that stuff. That's the fun stuff. But at some point, I'm chomping at the bit. I've got this clock ticking all the time. I want to get, especially now that I know the end of the story, I want to get to the end of the story. So at some point you just go, yeah, that's good enough. And it's never going to be final. But if you feel like you've got all the big pieces in place, I mean, all I'm doing is pulling shit out of a file cabinet and sticking it up on the bulletin board. If that doesn't work, I can go back to the file cabinet and start from scratch. And that always happens. But when I thumbnail a story, I will go through it with a red pen and kind of figure out, for this scene I need reference, for this scene I need reference, for this scene I need reference, and then I'll go and find all the bits that I think are going to work for those scenes and pin them up, so that I kind of feel like I've got my bases covered.
Christine, now, so you are not a comic book creator.
Correct.
You see the landscape though, so correct. I think you can look at the comic book landscape. You go to Comic-Con, you go to San Diego, and you can see it sort of like probably more removed than me or anybody in this room.
Yeah.
Aside from saving a nickel, what other advice could you give aspiring? This is a big question.
Yes.
And chew as much of it as you want. But, you know, sort of looking at the landscape and how it's even changed since you guys had started this, what do you see out there? I mean, what are some big mistakes you see happening, or what could people be doing better?
Well, I don't necessarily know what they can be doing better. You wanted to talk.
I'm not saying anything.
And I think companies too, publishing companies.
Well, I see like creator-owned comics seem to be really coming into their own. I mean, I know Image seems to be a great company to take your stuff to. DC and Marvel are just, I just don't think they're as friendly as they were. It seems just much more corporate, and they have, you know, it's great if you're just starting out and you want to get a feel for the whole business. I think those are good places to go.
Or make a name for yourself.
It's still high visibility. But then I this was the feeling, this is why I always gave him the advice of just like, you know, if you're really passionate about something, like you just have to stick with it. And even if it's, you got to get another job, or you got to find a wife with a job or a husband with a job or whatever. It's just something that if you don't try it, you'll never know.
I mean, at some point, of course, we never ran into it, but at some point, there would have come a time where you go, this isn't working.
Yeah, I would have definitely kind of, I hate to say pull the plug, but I would have said, like, you know, maybe this is not the best direction right now. But it's really like, if you don't try it, you're never going to know.
Would you need someone to tell you that, or would you already know?
I would have known.
You would know yourself?
I would have. You know what? If after I did the Hellboy story of the corpse, which is the one that worked, if that had just not sold, then it would have been a trick of, well, then go do either a commercial book for Dark Horse, which would have been the most comfortable. And the trade-off would have been, I would do a commercial book, and in between commercial books, I would do a Hellboy story or something of my own. And the beauty of that is, I could, you know, if they say, well, Hellboy isn't going to sell, you go, well, then fine, I'll do it for next to nothing. I'll do it. I mean, when I did The Amazing Scrawn Head, I knew that was an idea that only I thought was funny. Nobody was ever going to want it. So I said to Dark Horse, give me the worst deal you have, because I do not want you guys to lose money on a lot of money on this thing, or any money on this thing, hopefully. And I don't want you to be able to hold it over my head forever. Well, we bankrolled that ship job that you wanted to do. So I said, I'll do it for free. Or I think I did it for almost free, because I didn't want to be in the hole on it. So that's what I would have done. I think if I was still passionate about doing Hellboy, if I didn't lose interest in doing Hellboy, I would have done it in between commercial jobs.
I guess, like, have you noticed people compromising their creativity in order to make the business, or vice versa?
Well, I mean, everybody approaches this stuff really differently. I mean, I remember talking to one artist, one of the Image guys, and the book he was doing for Image was so much like the book he had just done at Marvel. And I said, why are you doing that? I mean, we all know you made a gazillion dollars off of this particular book at Marvel. Why are you continuing to do basically the same thing? And he said, well, it's my job. And I just realized we're wired so wildly differently, because if I had his fan following and his money in the bank, I'd be drawing Pinocchio. You know, I'd be doing some other weird-ass shit, because for a while, it meant people were going to buy it, and I've already made my money. I want to do stuff for myself. But there are guys out there that go, well, no, my job is to produce the work that I think the fans want. So they're, you know, that's just different. And again, I've seen so many guys doing comics that are clearly, they're just trying to sell a TV show or a movie.
Well, and then also from the merchandising standpoint, there's also people who will go and do T-shirts just because they think they want to sell, you know, 41 T-shirts. You should have your choice. But they're like crappy T-shirts. It's like volume, and it's like quantity and
quality,
not quantity.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so that happens all the time, especially with merchandise. Or there's also the $5 print. I mean, there's, you know, the crappy $5 print. There's a lot of them out there. Like, put a little bit into it.
Well, yeah, I mean, and even like professional artists, you go by their table at a convention and they've run off prints at Kinko's. And you're like, dude, instead of 10 different $5 Xerox prints, do two nice ones. It makes it, especially over time, it makes a difference if your association is quality.
Christine and Mike, and closing comments. Anything that you want to say or plug or?
No. Do you want to plug?
Nope.
Nope.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Mike, anything you want to add?
Absolutely nothing.
Nothing?
Well, thank you both.
Yeah, thank you guys. You guys are awesome.